नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये। What is the first verse of Vishnu Sahasranam? What is the second verse of Vishnu Sahasranam? Shuklam Bharadram is the first verse. Second verse is? Say it. Vyasam Vasishta Naptaram Shaktehe Pautram Akalmasham Parasharatmajam Vande Shukatatam Taponidhim. What does it mean? Vyasam, Vyasa, Vasishta Naptaram, Vasishta's great grandson, Naptaram, great grandson, Vasishta's great grandson, Vasishta Naptaram, Shaktehe Pautram, grandson of Shakti, Parasharatmajam, Akalmasham, Shakti is without any sins, Parasharatmajam, Parashara's son, Vyasa, Shukatatam, Shukacharya's, Shukabrahmar's father, Tapo Nidhim, the great Tapasvi Vyasa, Vibhotu, that is the. This is from Vishnu Sahasranam. Today we are not talking about Vishnu Sahasranam, but Vishnu Sahasranam is the almost one of the absolute crest jewels of our tradition is Vishnu Sahasranam. And where is it found? In which scripture is it found? Sorry? Mahabharata. We are talking Mahabharata. One of the crest jewels of Mahabharata is Vishnu Sahasranam, Bhishma tells. Okay. It is the essence and it is a good thing for people to learn it and chant it on a Thursday or a Saturday. There may be groups in your colony which do chanting of Vishnu Sahasranam. You can join that. It's a small book, you can buy it. If you learn it when you are young, you'll never forget it. I know of an elder gentleman who's no more, who passed away in his 80s. His religion was extended to two things. Morning when he used to get up, he used to chant the Aditya Hridayam, the Vishnu Sahasranam. Rest of the day he was in his, whatever he did. He lived a very beautiful life and he passed away very beautifully, listening to Vishnu Sahasranam being chanted. What is this? A wedding going on? Death. Good. So, taking the name of Vishnu. Right. So, that's a simple way of, and absolutely, like, which is available in our tradition, a very holy pursuit, but in a very simple manner, is listening to Vishnu. You get the cassette by M.S. Subbalakshmi. It is bound to make a stone get bhakti. Is that beautiful? Okay. Listening to it, and as our elders say, the person is standing near the Ganges River and he is feeling very, very thirsty. Oh, he decides to dig a well. And somebody goes and says, "Why? What are you digging a well for?" He says, "I am very thirsty." "Hey, but here's the Ganges. Why can't you drink that water?" Right? So they say, our elders say, pursuing other methods of worship is like digging a well when you can chant Vishnu Sahasranam, which is right there, like Ganges, the holiest of the whole. Pavitranam Pavitram Yog. Mangalanam to Mangalam. Most auspicious. One day when we are going through our Bharatam, we will also come to Sahasranam, we will talk about it. But I just thought, since the band was going, we must remember the name of Vishnu. Gita says, if a person passes away with the name of Narayana or Vishnu in his lips, he goes to Vaikuntham. Whatever he has done in his life. And our Acharya says, idam satyam, idam satyam, idam satyam, it is the truth, it is the truth, it is the truth. Three times. That if a person passes away with the name of God in his lips, he goes to heaven. whatever he has done in his life. So we come back to our story of Bharatam, and whatever he has done in his life, Mr. Dhritarashtra, is very sad, because the fame and the name of Pandavas is spreading far and wide. The people are very happy with Yudhishthira as the crown prince. The Pandavas have gone and conquered and acquired other kingdoms and made a lot of wealth. Yudhishthira is worried. He is losing sleep. Sorry, Dhritarashtra is worried. Excellent. He is losing sleep. He calls his mantri, Kanika, who has been trained by Shakuni, and asks him. And we said, what is a mantri? One uses his mind, man, mana, manasi, trayate, to go across. Mantri also is one who is learned in mantras. So you ask for counsel, he's your advisor, mantri. You ask him, so he asks him. He says, oh mantri, these Pandavas are flourishing day by day. Their praise is spreading everywhere. Oh Kanika, what should be my attitude towards them? Should it be of friendship? Or should I subdue them? What should be my right attitude? Should I control and conquer, or should I be amicable and friendly? What should be the right thing for me to do? Advise me. He asks Kanika, who has been trained by Shakuni. Kanika is very pleased that Dhritarashtra has asked him this question. It is like asking a carnivorous animal, say hyena, what diet one should take, whether you should eat fruit or you should eat some gory carnivorous meal. Hyena will laugh and tell you what all you should eat. Fruit will not figure in it. Like that, he asked Kanika. Kanika is pleased. He says, oh king, and he gives a big chapter. I will summarize it for you. What is the advice Kanika gives to Dhritarashtra? He says, oh king, personal power is paramount. And no king should forget that. And you must always exercise that power. Remember, people are afraid only of punishment. So, you must punish with a powerful arm. Dand. What good is a king who is not feared? You must punish with a powerful arm. If a king has any weaknesses, now first he is telling only general, he is telling the Niti, Raja Niti he is telling him. If a king has any weaknesses, he should hide them. He should not expose his weaknesses. At the same time, he should look for weaknesses in everybody else. And when you see an opponent to be weak, at that moment, you must strike. And when you strike, you must kill. No halfway measures. Kanika tells Dhritarashtra, you must safeguard your interests like a tortoise which withdraws its limbs under its shell. You know, a tortoise got a heavy shell. Withdraws its limbs under. When there's any attack, it'll just go under. Even a lion can't break that damn shell. Then slowly let it come out and walk slowly. God has given protection to all animals. He has given that shell to a tortoise. So he says, you must withdraw your safeguard your interest like that. And when you are dealing with an opponent, never leave him halfway. Okay, poich bottom. No. If you have a thorn in your feet, you don't pull it out halfway and leave it, do you? You pull the whole thing out. Likewise, never do anything by half. Kanika is elaborating to Dhritarashtra. No enemy is too small. Remember, even a small spark can set fire to the forest. A little matchstick is a harmful thing. So no enemy is too small. He is now warming up in his teaching of Adharma to Dhritarashtra. And when there may be times as a king that you are not on a strong wicket and your opponents are stronger, there may be times. At such times, people will even make ridicule. They'll ridicule you. They may make fun of you. They may talk tales about you. You may be blamed by people. At that time, be blind and deaf. Don't listen to them. Don't let that affect you. Don't see things that makes you feel you are weak. Don't do any of this. But become the ally of somebody strong and act totally subservient to him, loyal to him. Like that you be. Okay? But be like a hunter who pretends to sleep and wait for your opportunity alertly. Okay? He's telling. And he says, Daya na tasmin kartavya sharanagata ichyuta. He says, if somebody comes to you for sharanagati, refuge, an opponent comes and falls at your feet, daya na kartavya. Don't be a fool and show compassion. This is exactly opposite to what Rama promises in Ramayana. His mission statement he gives in Ramayana. Okay. Vratam, he says. This is my vratam. That anybody who comes as Charnagatam to me, I will protect. Be it even Ravana. Even if Ravana comes as Charnagati to me, I will have to protect. This is my dharma. This is my vratam. Rama says, here Kanika advises Dhritarashtra, don't be a fool. If somebody comes and does sharanagati to you, don't make the mistake of showing mercy to him. A king can be fearless only if all his enemies are killed. No threat perception should be there. All right. You must use all means to control everybody. You must use sama, you must use dana, you must use bheda, and you must use, what is the fourth method? Danda. All of sama, dana, bheda, danda, these are the four upayams. What are the four upayams? Sama means what? Like for example, suppose your parents or somebody tells, listen, you must study every day at least 1 hour a day. Never postpone anything to tomorrow. What you must do today. You must pray at least for 5 minutes in the puja room before you go to school. Something like that they say. And if you do that, it will be good for you, it will be good for the family, you will do well in life and all that. They are explaining to them. That is sama. Or dana. If you study every day and you do puja for 5 minutes before you go to school, I'll give you 100 rupees pocket money every month or 200 rupees pocket money every month. Dana. Bribe the fellow. Okay? I will allow you to eat chocolate only if you do puja every day in the morning for 2 minutes. At least for that, the fellow will go and do puja and come. I did today morning. Okay. Danam. Vedam. See, Mrinalini is doing, Lavanya is not doing. Bhedam. Okay? Compare and conquer. You say that person is better, this person, why you are not studying, you see that girl, she is studying every day for 1 hour, she has become first in the class, she has got merit card and all that stuff, and here, you know, you all the time, I have to put up a face to your father when you bring the report card. Look at that person, like that, bhedam. Then, best method, dandam. If you don't study every day for 1 hour, I'm going to beat you. Not solid knock on the head. Mostly 1 to 2 generations back, this dandam was used very well. Spare the rod and spoil the child, didn't they? They used to be pretty good in using dandam. Everybody understands dandam. Other three is a little bit difficult. Nobody is there who does not understand dandam. So Dhritarashtra is being trained by Kanika. See, the problem is, depends on the person. With Ravanan, there's no point doing Samam, Danam or Bhedam. Dandam only, that's what Hanuman says when he first goes to Lanka. He thinks, Hanuman is supposed to be the best person in terms of Upaya. He's a thinker. He thinks, how should I leave a proper message to Ravana? No point talking to that fellow. No point bribing him. What will you do Bhedam with him? Set fire to Lanka, Dandam. Samadana Bheda Danda. So all these methods have to be tried but the opponent, the objective is the opponent should be mercilessly finished. Kanika telling him. Have spies all over the land. Have spies everywhere in temples, in hospitals, in crowded places, in markets. Wherever there are places people congregate, have spies. Listen to what people are saying. Listen to what everybody is talking. Keep abreast of what is happening. Same time, get everybody's respect by doing good deeds. People should think well of you. You should perform yagams, sacrifices. You should have matted hair. Keep ekadashi vratams. Go for pilgrimage. Be seen to be good. Right? But when you get an opportunity, attack like a wolf. Okay? Now, what your objective has to be clear. The fruit is important. You must realize you need the fruit. But if you can't reach the fruit, and if you can reach the fruit only by sitting on somebody's shoulder, then by all means sit on somebody's shoulder to get the fruit. But look for an opportunity and break that fellow's head later. This Kanika is elaborate, yes. This is the Rajniti of a certain kind. This is not Rajadharmam as Bhishma told Yudhishthira later. This is Shakuni's and Kanika's ways of holding on to power, which is largely practiced in this day and age. Right? So, like that. Break his head like a pot on a rock. Even if the fellow surrenders, show no compassion. All, he goes on and on. Okay? Then he says, I'll tell you a story. Once upon a time in a forest, there was a tiger, a jackal, a mongoose, and a rat, and a wolf. What are the five animals? Yeah, they were friends. As unlikely as you get them, but that's the way life is. You got to make friends with who's around you. They were friends. And they were in the forest and they were hungry. And they saw a deer running around, prancing. Running, whoosh. So they looked to the tiger. Tiger started chasing. But deer was too fast for the tiger, left it behind and went away, disappeared. You know how a tiger, the way a deer runs is very beautiful, no? It doesn't run, no, it like that. Like that, you know, it's apparently an optical illusion it creates. By that method, that's a different story. So it's not able, they are not able to catch it. Tiger is not able to catch it. Then jackal says, I have an idea. We'll wait for the deer to sleep. But the problem is, this deer also, if it smells the tiger coming, it will know. So tiger can't approach it easily. So he says, I have an idea, let it sleep. We ask the rat, when the fellow is sleeping, to go and bite his hoof, properly bite him in the leg. Then later he'll not be able to run so fast. Then you can catch him. Tiger says, good idea. So they implemented. So in the night, deer is sleeping. It goes and bites. Morning it gets up, whatever. Tiger runs, catches it, kills it. Now five people, whatever, these guys have to now share the meal. Jackal says, "Ellar kulichitonga, all of you go take a bath nicely and then come." No, Jackal not such a fool. It sends him. Oh, everybody, but Tiger quickly jumps to the river, has a bath and comes back, ready to eat. All of them slightly later. Jackal's waiting. Jackal doesn't do proper kanika. Jackal is sitting thoughtfully near the dead deer. And Tiger comes and says, "What are you looking like that for? What are you lost in thought?" He says, "No, actually, as per our tradition, we don't eat something which we have not got by our own might. If you have taken resort to some lower somebody else, then we will not eat it. Now, this rat has gone and bit the tiger, that, so I am not too sure. But you may eat, but I don't know whether I want to eat." Tiger says, "Nuts, I am not going to trust this animal. You're right, I forgot for a moment, I should have killed it by myself. I am not going to eat it," and he goes away. Sama, in its own way, this fellow has done. Then the rat comes. When the rat comes, this jackal tells him, "Rat, come here. I don't know. This mongoose was saying that because the tiger has bitten this deer, the deer has become poisonous. Tiger is gone. Deer has become poisonous. Now mongoose is saying that because he is hungry, he'll eat you up. He'll eat you up. He is planning to eat you up." He tells the rat. Rat scoots. "Thanks for the tip." Then the wolf comes. "Wolf," this fellow tells, "Brother Wolf, I want to warn you straight away. This tiger is angry with you. Don't ask me why, what and all. He is angry with you." Wolf ducks. "Tiger is angry with me." He splits. The mongoose comes. Jackal shouts at him saying, "I bloody chased away the tiger, the wolf and finished the rat. If you want, you can take me on. Otherwise, I'll kill you if you want to take me on." If mongoose says it killed, but it chased away the tiger and this thing, what chance do I have? He goes away. This is Jackal eats it. So Kanika says, "No, you got to be like this. You have to use your mind and use all your ingenuity and finish your enemies. There are different types of opponents. If the opponent is afraid of you, you terrify him. Scare the hell out of him. If he's a greedy fellow, you bribe him. Okay. If he is a strong fellow, pretend to be loyal to him, but wait for a chance to hit him. Don't look whether he's your son, he's your friend, he's your father, he's a chitappa, nothing. Nothing is important. Personal power is important. But at the same time, never show your true emotion to anybody. Never be angry. Never display anger. Speak sweetly. Never let anybody suspect what you are thinking also. And after you do the job, after you finish your opponent, after you kill them, shed profuse tears. Cry in public. Pretend to be magnanimous. Observe grief. Pretend to be magnanimous, compassionate, etc. "Although he was my opponent, We were good friends." Every time you hear that, politics. Pretend. Welcome your opponent, give him asan, bhojan, give him food, but when opportunity comes, bury your fangs into him and bite him to death. Make elaborate promises, give assurances, bend low, bow, do everything, but be always sure that personal power is important. And among your people, your next in line, third in command, fourth in command, such people, if people have any ambitions or desires, stoke it. Stoke that fire, but never let them achieve it. Never let them achieve it. Postpone, delay, explain away. Wait, it will be done, the right time will come. But you see that person, this reason, keep giving reasons, don't let them achieve their desires. Be like a sword which is hidden in a sheath. Be like a tree full of flowers which has no fruit. What use? Be like a tree full of flowers which has no fruit, even if fruits are there, have it so high that nobody can climb to get it. And fruit should be such that it should look ripe, but it should be raw. And if somebody manages to climb the tree and pluck the fruit and eats the raw fruit, be sure that he is not able to digest what he eats. It's like, you know, there's an old saying in English, proverb called, giving a gift as white elephant as a gift. What does it mean? If you get an elephant as a gift, forget white, how can you maintain it? Not able to make ends meet as it is. An elephant needs much more salary than what you can afford for one day. What salary you will get for 1 year, you will not be able to do. There is an interesting R.K. Narayan story where somebody gets in a fair, he gets a prize, road roller. One fellow gets a road roller as a prize. His life becomes miserable after that. He is not able to remove it. The corporation files a notice on him saying your road roller is blocking. You have to take it. It becomes a mess. Like that. He's not able to digest the fruit. Like that he tells all this. And says, so, as far as the Pandavas are concerned, be wary of them, wait for an opportunity, deal with them very carefully, but deal with them in a way that you do not end up regretting later. Be careful in your dealing. Okay. So, Dhritarashtra is lost, he's thinking what to do. Meanwhile, his illustrious son, Duryodhana, is not far behind in his thinking. He is thinking, Pranadikam Bhimasenam Kritavidyam Dhananjayam Duryodhano Lakshetva Paryetapyata Durmanaha. Duryodhana, bad-minded Duryodhana, is getting very, very tappa. I mean, he is burning because day by day Bhima is growing in strength, day by day Arjuna is growing in valor. He is burning. And he goes to his father and says, Father, I want to tell you something. I heard the citizens of the country speaking. They are not speaking well of you. They are not speaking well of Bhishma. They are all praising this Yudhishthira only. And I think one of these days they will want to make Yudhishthira the king. And I don't know what to do about it. Now, Bhishma will not mind if Yudhishthira becomes the king. He doesn't mind anything. He's like that. Nadugatta. But what happens to me? What happens to us? If Yudhishthira becomes the king, then later his son will become the king. That fellow's son will become the king. I will not get any kingdom. What about our children? We will be reduced to a state where we have to depend on somebody else for our food. It will be like hell. He tells Dhritarashtra. And then says, Dhritarashtra says, son. And he says, you must tell us, Duryodhana tells him to Dhritarashtra, Father, King, you must adopt some means by which we will not be reduced to such a state. Which means ensure Yudhishthira does not become the king. I become the king. We must do something. Dhritarashtra thinks deeply and says, son, it's like this. Pandu led a life of good life, dharma. He dealt with everybody as per dharma, especially with me. Every day in the morning he used to tell, this is your kingdom to me. He used to be more concerned about me than about himself. His son Yudhishthira is also like that. Now, they are so good, they have been good to the people, they have been good to their ministers, their soldiers, not only to ministers, soldiers, Yudhishthira has been good to their sons and grandchildren also. You must bear all this in mind. They have got too much support right now. You cannot do anything hastily. These people may turn and kill us if we do anything. The soldiers and the mantris. Duryodhana says, no, dad. I know how much support they have, and it is not that we also lack support. We also have support. Don't worry about that. I have been keeping everybody happy from my side. I have been doing my bit. And as far as these others are concerned, right now I have ensured that the key ministers and the treasury is under my control. There is a town called Varnavat. He says, think of some reason to send Pandavas and Kunti and everybody to Varnavat. Let them stay there for a while. Meanwhile, I'll get control of the kingdom here. After I am properly established, let them come back. But until that time, I want them out of the way. If you can think of some reason to tell them to go there. Dhritarashtra says, actually, I was also thinking along these lines. But I didn't say it openly because it is a sin. It will be committing a papam. And I don't know whether Bhishma, Drona and Kripacharya etc. will agree or will not see through this plan. Whether they will agree to send Pandavas and Kunti away for a period of time, that I don't think so. And if they even get a hint of this kind of a thing, they may turn against us. We cannot have Bhishma and Drona and all turning against us. It's fraught with peril. Duryodhana says, no, don't worry. See, Bhishma is always non-partisan, he'll not take sides. Ashwatthama, I have ensured he'll be in our side. Whichever side Ashwatthama is, his father Drona will be in that side. And Drona and Ashwatthama being with us means Kripacharya will be with us. This is Kripacharya's brother-in-law is Drona, his nephew is Ashwatthama. So as far as Bhishma, Drona, Ashwatthama and Kripacharya are concerned, they'll all be with us, not to worry. Duryodhana is saying, please, discard, don't worry, send Pandavas etc. to that place. What is that place? Varnavata. I am burning, there is a thorn pricking in my heart, the whole heart is burning, I am in deep trouble, please give me relief, please somehow send them to Varnavat as soon as possible, preferably today. Duryodhana asks Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra says, okay, but I can't do it today, I'll start doing it. So what he does is, meanwhile both of them hatch a plan. Duryodhana starts heavily giving gifts to all the ministers, generals, whenever I'm feeling happy today, take this necklace, whatever, he starts giving gifts. And Dhritarashtra, through some key mantris, starts spreading stories about it, Varnavat. What a beautiful place, Varnavat. And there's a Shiva festival coming there, Lord Shiva. Lovely festival of Shiva is coming there. Grandly going to be celebrated, it will be like a heaven on earth, like that. He starts spreading that information to everybody, and naturally it comes to Kunti's ears also and Pandava's ears also, and they are also hearing, oh, grand festival, Varnavat, etc. They are hearing. It's called hype, spreading the hype. And then one day Dhritarashtra calls these Pandus and says, sons, you have completed your studies, everything is fine. You might have heard there's this festival coming in Varnavat. All the ministers are saying they want to go. So it's going to be celebrated in a very grand manner. I think that somebody good from the royalty also should go there and add to be there. And I would suggest that you, all of you with your friends and relations and your mother, go to Varnavat. Give Dhanam liberally. Be there for the festival. Spend some time. Take your worries off now, take off on a good holiday, do some good deeds and then come back. As soon as he says this, Yudhishthira smells a rat. He is where? He is suddenly asking us to go, but you can't say no to the king. He says okay, but he goes quickly to all the elders, to Bhishma, Gandhari, Kripacharya, Dronacharya and everybody. Yudhishthira says, Dhritarashtra has asked us to go to Varnavata and spend some time there. So we are going. We need your ashirvadam, your blessings, that we have a good trip and no difficulty comes to us. Individually, he goes to each elder and conveys this message very clearly. Meanwhile, Duryodhana calls his trusted minister called Purochana and says, listen, I am going to entrust you with a very, very secret, delicate mission. Nobody else should know about it, not even Dhritarashtra should know about it. Okay? Pandavas are going to Varnavat. You will go there and make a lovely mansion for them to stay. You should have the best comfort. All null beds should just sink in. Comfortable beds, comfortable places to sit, Unjal, fountain, pond, this, that, lovely place that Pandavas would love to stay there, and Dhritarashtra will be happy that Pandavas has got such a nice place to stay. Such a place you must construct. Only thing is, it should be made fully with inflammable material. You use wood, you use ghee, you use wax, you use butter, you use oil, and you use such material. And surround that place also with inflammable material, but nobody should suspect that it is inflammable. Make it so beautifully that it looks like a terrific mansion that they would love to stay with all their facilities. And when the right time comes, set fire to it from inside when these people are there. I will let you know when that is. Set fire to it so people think it's an accident. This is a very delicate mission. Nobody should know about it. Start immediately. Salam, and he goes. Purochana goes. Now Pandavas, now they touch the feet of all the elders, do pradakshinam to all the elders, and they leave for Varnavata, and they are given a royal welcome there. But before they go there, this Vidura, Dhritarashtra's brother, he comes to know of this plot. He is a very wise man, and he comes to know of this plot, and he speaks. He can speak a coded language which Yudhishthira understands. Okay, I am transcribing it in a different way in English, but something like this he tells him. There is a weapon called Kuvikudu which is not made of iron, yet it can kill. Be careful, a tree can set a forest on fire, but when a forest catches fire, rats can escape because they can go into their holes. But if they are blind, they will not be able to see their way. Isn't it? But the Kuvikudu will not be able to affect it if the rats go off into the holes. So know the directions by looking at the stars. Keep the five senses together and under control and be undefeated. He tells Yudhishthira. There is a weapon called Kuvikudu, not made of iron. You know this Kana Bhasha? What is Kuvikudu? There is a weapon called Vidu which is not made of iron, yet it can kill. So he is giving this type of message to Yudhishthira. He gives this message. And Yudhishthira quickly understands. He says, oh, I get it. He tells to Vidura. Meanwhile, this Kunti is listening keenly. Like a grandmother, mother, she is learning. These people are talking something, when right time she asked Yudhishthira, I saw you and Vidura talking something in coded language. Nothing will escape her. She is a lady. And if you don't mind, if it is not wrong, if it is not inappropriate, will you tell me what he told you? Okay. Mother is asking. Yudhishthira can't say no. He tells her, no, this is what he told. Okay. Now they have a grand welcome in that place. And they are having a good time. And this man constructs a place called Shiva Bhavan. That mansion of lac, of wax, is called Shiva Bhavan, which is meant to do only Ashivam. Called it Shiva Bhavan. And he invites them and they stay there grandly. As soon as they go in there, this guy smells trouble. Yudhishthira, because he says, he calls Bhima and says, Bhima, I can smell that these walls are made of all oily stuff, and I can smell ghee, and I can smell butter, and I can smell wax. this twam place is totally inflammable. He tells Bhima. Yeah, smelling trouble. Literally smells it. Apparently God has got a reason why he's kept the nose in front of the mouth. Firstly, when there's good food being cooked in the house, you know by smelling it. Potatoes being made, fried in the kitchen. Nice. Ah, immediately tongue, stomach, mind, everything gets into unison. At the same time, if there's some rotten food and you're about to put it in your mouth, smell itself will keep it aside. If the smell was not there, that food would have gone into the mouth. Had the nose been in the hand, you're not going to show it there and then put it in the mouth. It's a problem. Okay? Okay. It's right there where it should be. Before the food goes, that's the strategic importance. That's the sama part of the nose, that the wrong food does not get in. The dana part of the nose is even the food next door is so nice, you'll get nice smell. Okay. That's the dana part. Anyway. So he smells this and then tells Bhima immediately, oh, what reaction, man. No, relax. Let us not let anybody know that we suspect. We know that this is place is inflammable. Let us not leave this place either and go to some other place, because then Duryodhana will know that we have understood. And if Duryodhana knows that we have understood, then he will hatch some other plan. And that plan we may not know what he does, when he does, through whom he does. At least now we know what trouble is awaiting us and we can take care. And we will do something, don't worry. And there's no point running away, because he'll send people behind us to kill us. What we should do is, every day we will roam around and first map this place, survey this area, find out the directions, what is where. So when we escape, we know where to escape. Right? Meanwhile, Vidura sends a trusted man, quietly to Yudhishthira, who introduces himself and says, Vidura sent me, I'm an expert tunnel digger. Vidura has asked me to help you dig a tunnel. He says, come. And then that man digs a long tunnel from the middle of the house to outside somewhere, somewhere far away from the house, he builds a tunnel. During daytime, the Pandavas go hunting. Whole day they are hunting. And night time, this Bhima goes and stands guard near the door. So Purochana is not getting an opportunity to set fire to the house. Bhima standing nearby, it's not easy to do that. So after many days of staying there, Yudhishthira says, now the time has come. Tonight, when Purochana is sleeping, let us set fire to the house from inside. And we will escape. But they need to think we are dead. So go to the cremation ground and get 5 male bodies and a woman's body from the cremation ground. Quietly, we'll keep it in the house, set fire to it. Set fire to it. So they get that and they set fire to it. They set fire right outside the room of Purochana. Purochana also dies in the fire. And they escape through the tunnel. And who is the leader in the escape? Who is the main person? Who is Bhima? Bhima is as fast as the wind. He is Vayuputra. And he is strong. He keeps Kunti, his mother, on his shoulder. He lifts Nakula and Sahadeva like children on this thing. They are both hanging on for dear life onto his waist, 2 sides of his waist. And he picks up Arjuna and Yudhishthira in his 2 hands and he charges out through the... Okay? It's a lovely picture. It's there in Bharata, the photo of that. It looks so nice. Okay? Sorry? He was huge. Yes, he was. 10,000 elephants. At the end of the tunnel, where the tunnel came out, Vidura had sent another man, a trusted man who was waiting for them. And he was a boatman, and a lovely fast boat which was driven by machine was ready for them. The boatman introduced himself, asked them to get into the boat, drove the boat across the river and took them to a far off place and set them there and then gave them the message. tell that Vidura sends his love to all of you. He says, in his mind he hugs you and he smells your crown and kisses your head, all of you. The boatman tells the Pandavas. And Vidura says, he conveys his blessings and he asks you to go in peace and he says, all will be well eventually. And now I have to go. And the boatman goes back. Pandavas have now in a strange place, they have to hide, they have to pretend to be dead, right? And in Varnavata, there is heavy chaos. Pandavas steal into the darkness. There's heavy chaos. This is all they do in the night. The heavy chaos, the house burning, just reduced. Huge mansion reduced to nothing. People are all shouting, ha 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 ha, whole town has come. And Pandavas are inside. There also, as soon as it settles down a bit, that tunnel digger is the first one to say, let us search for Pandavas, he says. And he goes there inside and quickly, completely covers that tunnel. Usually in a crisis, the first person who acts may be the one who created it. You can never know. Okay. So he quickly hides the tunnel. People are all shaken. And the news goes that the Pandavas, they find the bodies, 5 and 1 and 6 and Purochana. And they feel they are dead, and everybody is grief stricken. Dhritarashtra is crying, weeping that Pandavas are dead, Kunti is dead, and all. Duryodhana is weeping, beating his chest, my brothers are dead, and I'm so. All of them are crying. Bhishma is broken hearted, and Bhishma is thinking, how could this have happened? How could this have happened? He's thinking. How could these Pandavas have died? This was not we. How could a great man like Yudhishthira, a strong man like Bhima, a valorous man like Arjuna, how could they be dead? Dhikkar to Kalam, he's shouting. And he's thinking, he's worrying. And then they have to do the Shraddham, Jalanjali. They have the Ganges, they have to, Tarpanam, they have to do for the departed soul. Bhishma being the eldest, he has to do it for the Pandavas. He's sitting in grief. All Duryodhana, everybody is sitting there, Vidura is sitting there. He has to do the tarpanam. He takes, at that time, Vidura turns and tells him quietly, without anybody hearing, he tells Bhishma, mantra shalla dengo. Don't say the mantra. Immediately Bhishma understands that what he is telling is, he says, don't tell mantram of shraddham. Bhishma understands that that means that these fellows are not dead. Because if Bhishma utters the Shraddha Mantram, they will die if they are not dead. Bhishma is not like me. If somebody had come and told me, I would have said, yeah, mantra shalla dengo. Chalrani. Why are you saying? He is not like that. He quickly understands. He's a smart fellow. He is able to link. He is not an idiot. So he understands, he quickly says, and Shengalpur Mantram Dikshitar in his discourse, he says, I wish he had that day instead of, he didn't say the mantram for Pandavas, but instead if he had said Duryodhanam Tarpayami, that fellow would have died. Anyway, he doesn't do that. And he pretends to say the mantram and do the shraddham, etc., without saying anything. And we come to the end of today's story, with the Pandavas having escaped into the darkness from the house of Lak, from the Lakshagraham, it's called in Sanskrit and in Tamil. And Duryodhana is thinking that they are dead. Dhritarashtra thinks that they are dead. He suspects Duryodhana has a hand in it. Duryodhana is extremely happy. But the Pandavas have escaped. Vidura knows that they have escaped. He has been the one who has helped them escape. And Bhishma also knows that they are not dead. And that note we come to today's class. Namaha Parvati Pataye. जानकी कांत स्मरणम्।
गोपिका जीवन स्मरणम वेट्रिवेल मुरुगनक श्री सद्गुरु स्वामिनः श्री आंजनेय स्वामिनः
बुद्धिर्बलम सिंग इट Where was Hanuman during the Mahabharata war? If you look at the famous painting of Gita, Bhagavad Gita, on the flag. Thank you. Correct. By Duryodhana.